Hello, folks. You're listening to Busker Broadcast, and I'm Abby the Spoon Lady, and we've got Josh and Peter here. And we're talking about busking and hand pans and didgeridoos and whatnots. So, y'all want to introduce yourselves and tell me a little bit of what you're about?
Sure. Hey, I'm Josh Newton. I'm a percussionist, and today with me I have a hand pan and I have tabla, which are Indian hand drums, and I play on the street full-time.
Yeah, I'm Peter Levitov. I moved to town 3 years ago for busking, particularly, and to be closer to the community of folks who play this weird spaceship instrument, the steel hand pan. I also play full-time. I play didgeridoo as well. And yeah, I sure do like it.
It's fun stuff.
So y'all consider yourselves full-time street performers?
That is correct.
And do you feel like being a full-time street performer is a hard thing to describe to people?
Yeah, well, you can describe certain things about it, but there's like to actually be on the street and to be interacting with people in that way and get to know the local wildlife, so to speak. It, like, to be within that is something that's hard to describe. You really get to know the city and how cities move and convey energy, and you can't really replace, you just have to be there to understand that. You have to watch it.
Yeah, that's a good way of putting it.
I think there's a lot of aspects that, you know, with anything you do is hard to understand until you're fully in it. Like, everything ranging from, oh, this is great, but not really understanding how much effort it takes to sustain doing this work and bringing it to, like, pity. Where it's like, you know, you don't have to be here, man. You really don't have to be here. You could be somewhere else. Like, I'm like, yeah, I know. I know I don't have to be here, but I adore it. I adore it here. Yeah. Most days.
Yeah, I get that. Well, why aren't you playing inside? And then I have to explain to them because I like what I'm doing, and it's easier to make a living this way anyway.
Yeah, yeah, both of those.
Kind of democratizes the process instead of like having a venue owner and having that whole deal or a production company and that whole system of economics. It's just like you and the people who enjoy it, and there's nothing to filter that.
Yeah, for me to play indoors, it's showing up, having to talk with somebody, I have to set everything up, figuring out where I'm at, sound check, this, that, versus busking, show up, have a great time, make some money, go home.
That's right, and the wall is thinner, too, between me and the people I'm interacting with, the people who are listening. On stage, it's either the bar scene or there's like this great expanse between me and the audience that I can cross over a little bit with words and this and that. But on the street, we can really physically interact. There's children dancing, families enjoying themselves. And that's one of the best, most beautiful parts of that work.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. So you brought some of your instruments in. Y'all want to play a little bit?
Yeah.
Yeah, we can do something like that.
Yeah. Y'all got a lot of equipment. I worry about your backs sometimes.
Yeah.
And lifting form is important.
Me too.
Knees, not the back.
So a little background on the instrument. The steel hand pan was invented in 2000, 2001, depending on who you speak to, in Switzerland. And by two folks out there, Felix and Sabina. And they were steel drum makers, and it's certain direction evolution of the steel hand pan. So it's a melodic percussive steel, and it's sensitive enough to be played with the fingers. Yeah, and we've got really a broad range of all the instrumentation here from different makers around the world who started working from close to the beginning over the last 7 years.
Yeah, I can see how your drums are slightly different. I wish the folks on the radio could see this.
Yeah, every maker has a different style, and their energy goes into the instrument. You can really feel the specific aesthetic. This one was made in Russia.
And what about that one?
This one was made about 25 minutes away from here by Siraz, which is in Swannanoa, North Carolina.
Wow.
Awesome. So even with that, you can hear Peter and I have the exact same scale, except he has one additional high note. My high note is this one. his is... But other than that, we have the same notes. But listening to his and mine, you can tell the difference in the tone.
Oh, totally. That's kind of neat.
Yeah, it's fun. It's fun to have those different timbres and slightly different energies. And what's really fun about this is I did 2 years of busking, and this is the one instrument that really mics well for me on the street and carries and is robust and rust resistant and sun tolerant, which is not very common for hand pans. So I play this one scale like all the time for the last 2 years, and this year, just by coincidence, we didn't really plan it, but we have played a little bit, Josh doing percussion, and he happened to get the same exact scale. So this year we had the delight to discover, hey, this works really nicely together.
It was cool.
Random too. We just showed up to the same spot at the same time on a Sunday morning, right?
Yeah.
And just both had our rigs. I'm like, all right, well, may as well. Let's do it.
Let's do a crossover when we trade places. Like, wait a minute. Let's not trade places ever. Let's just do this together. Because it's really exhausting doing a solo thing on the street.
Yeah.
Like carrying all the energy, trying to do it. Like I support my family during the summer with this work, and it's a lot of work to carry all by myself, and playing the didgeridoo can be very exhausting. So it's a nice break, having someone else be able to hold it down.
Yeah. Well, you want to play us a little something?
Yeah. Yeah.
Do you have a title for what you're going to play?
We could make one up, I guess.
I tend to ask for uploading.
Yeah. So what a format we do often, we both have a love for improvisation. So that's 100% what we do on the street is improvising all the time.
You say improv.
But what we do is what we've gotten in the habit of doing is trying to make excuses to celebrate and honor life in a particular way and focus our energy in a particular way. So oftentimes when we're feeling kind of dried out or whatever, we'll drop an idea for an energy to dedicate the song to, whether it's the water or a certain animal or our ancestors or anything like that. So we could do that.
Yeah, we could do that. I'm kind of feeling, since you mentioned water, water is kind of how I'm feeling right now.
Okay, for the water. Thank you for sustaining life around the world. Thank you.
is great.
Weeds.
So, what about, you know, good moments that you've had on the street? Hmm. Or, you know, things that stick out?
There's so many. I'm trying to like come up with like a different like a category of like which one. I mean, there's the kid moments, and you know, yeah, that's lovely. Not too much to say there. It's kind of like a being there thing. Kids really let loose. You know, they fully experience the music in a way that a lot of adults don't. That's really great generally, and that happens all the time.
And it's really a great, very visceral example of how connected we are on the street. And for me, really, the people I enjoy watching the most in terms of street performers are those who really recognize that it's a give and a take, and that we're all really connected. So they're really engaged with the people. So a child starts dancing, having fun, smiling, whatever, feeling mystified, and the people see that and they get excited, and we see that and we get excited, and the music gets more energy, and then they get more excited, and it feeds itself in a really beautiful way.
Yeah. Yeah, of course it does. do you feel like folks genuinely accept you here? Like, do you feel at home when you're playing?
I feel more at home here than anywhere I've tried to play music in the past, especially busking. I play a lot of world music that's strange, and I really love to improv with everything. And in the past, I found a lot of resistance, because like, this is how we play music here, and it's like this, and whether it's an old-timey thing or whatever. And I have found a lot more acceptance here, and I feel like both, definitely folks are really grateful on the street who come through, tourists, because it's different than anything they've ever seen, and the instrument is so new, it's generally a delightful surprise for them, which I think brings them back to that childhood energy where everything was a delightful surprise, and we see stuff all the time, so we get bored, and it's rare that we see something we have no context for in this life. So I think it brings us, yeah, all glittery and sparkly, like seeing a flower for the first time or something.
That's a really good way of putting that. I really enjoy that.
And definitely. I mean, and that's really the beautiful thing about the street is when you're in a venue, people come because they want to see you. They know about you. They're interested in what you're doing. On the street, everyone's coming, and it's a surprise. And we're trying to find ways more and more to engage people in just appreciating that simple, beautiful fact. Like, hey, we're all here on a busy day, moving around, and we're listening to music all together.
Yeah.
What is up with that? That's something special. I know it's simple and it sounds almost silly, but really, like, look, y'all, look how, you know, with all the differences we all have, all our stories and whatever, religions, socioeconomic and cultural backgrounds and all this, look how much we have in common in the most simple, basic, beautiful ways.
Do you feel like, trying to figure out the right way to word this, how do you feel like busking should be preserved?
Well,
how do we keep this real for our children, our children's children?
Well, it's there's a lot of factors in that. I mean, busking, by whatever name it's been called, is one of the oldest professions in the world. It's one of the oldest human traditions, is that art travels with the people making it. And I think it's really important to preserve that. I think one of the greatest threats to that is the way that we deal with public space as a culture, especially here in America, where, like, for example, I'm from Atlanta, and to go back to the previous question, I feel way more welcome here than anywhere else, but especially Atlanta, because it's such a big city and there's so much violence and chaos and all that, that people shut off. They don't really look at each other in the eyes. They don't interact on the streets. I mean, but then there's stuff like, you know, insurance and liabilities, so you can't climb on things, like the Flatiron downtown, for example. Like, the notion that you can't play in your environment, you know, or you can't run, or, like, there's all these, even if they're not laws, there's all these ideas about how one behaves in public, what's appropriate, what's not, And our standards for that in this country seem to not help us feel comfortable as if, like, we are in our home when we're in public, as if we're, as we can experience emotions, we can talk to each other, we can laugh, we can cry, whatever it is.
You just naturally don't feel at home when you walk outside.
Right. Like, you're always, you know, you cross the street, straight line when the sign is on, and there's these lights here, yeah. And there's signs everywhere, and this is public property, and that's private property, and there's all these different factors to consider at all times that, I don't know, people get into boxes, they sort of get into conditioned behavior, you know? Like, it's easy, especially in big cities, to use the zombie imagery, because a lot of people, I think, to feel safe and to feel less overstimulated, just shut off in a lot of ways.
Put the blinders on.
And so as buskers, I feel like that is one of our primary roles, is to jolt people out of that.
Yeah, there you go.
But we do, and as we're learning here in Asheville, there, when it comes to laws and regulations, especially around busking, there's a lot of different ideas that don't necessarily bode well for the surviving to the next generation.
Right.
And so Now it's becoming an activism and advocacy thing to make sure that systems of authority don't crush it accidentally or on purpose, depending on where and what and who you ask.
Right. Plenty of cities have accidentally crushed their music culture by trying to fix certain aspects of it. Mm-hmm. And it never works. It's kind of a take it or leave it kind of situation when it comes to busking, and it might be a little bit rough around the edges, but the end result is beautiful.
Mm-hmm. I agree, and I think that's something really important to consider, because I have my own opinions, and they change from, you know, moment to moment sometimes, depending upon the context, but I recognize it's not really a black and white issue. There's so many perspectives to look at and to really consider, and but with anything, like, I come to the street, and there are days where it's so tough and rough that I really feel like I just want to go home and hide and never share again. Like, just, no way, I'm done. This is, I put my heart out there, and it's just, you know, and I hear that a lot. And then there are days where it's, wow, this is the most extraordinary thing I could possibly be doing with my life, too, because something happens where someone's really touched, like the homeless person who has nothing and takes jewelry off of his hand. Yeah. So he can have something to give me to show appreciation, and, you know, all those little moments. So and it's really easy when it's good to think that's forever, this is great, I love this, and when it's bad to think, oh, this is forever. And
mm-hmm. And both of those in a single day this past week.
That's right.
Saturday morning,
that's
Saturday
right.
night.
Oh yeah, I think that was my Saturday too. Yeah. I was a little bipolar on Saturday, if anybody ran into me.
We can blame it on cosmic forces.
Yeah.
So what I'm trying to say is whatever you do, life is a mixed bag. People are a mixed bag. We're good and bad together. Yeah. And like, if I'm in a good, stable place, I recognize, like, there are going to be people I love who are going to let me down. There are going to be people who are frustrating to me that surprise me and are wonderful. And if a city wants this sort of culture alive, that they're to some degree going to have to deal with having a little bit of the rough stuff, and along with all of the overwhelming good that happens. And I think it's tricky, because my personal stance is I do this full-time, I do it professionally, and I strive to bring professionalism to my work just like any other job. You know, show up in a way that is respectful to the business owners, show up in a way that's respectful to my coworkers, and to the people who are there. And although I am trying to shake a little bit, I'm also not trying to shake so much that people become uncomfortable, because I don't think that's necessarily my role. That being said, I know, like, I've come to this later in my life. I know that if I came 10 years ago when I was younger, that I would have made a fool of myself. And I think that's useful for some people. I know a lot of folks that have really grown up and matured through doing this work on the street. So really, in a perfect world, I'd like to see the community of buskers be more tolerant of one another, be more patient, and the elders to take time to really educate folks who are rough around the edges. to the best that we can, and for the city to be tolerant and patient and do their best to make it easy for the people who are really contributing and who do it full time and are local, and to recognize that these people are giving a lot for the city. And, you know, not make it difficult for us by making us feel guilty for selling our own music.
Right, or advertising about us without even talking to us.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, the issue is for folks to understand that what we're doing is a valid thing, that it's okay. It is totally okay for us to be out there. It's totally okay for them to do the same, and that it should be that way across the country, because otherwise all these little art forms would just die off.
Yeah,
and that's the basic facts of it.
There's another level I'd like to see. I mean, beyond what you said, what you'd like to see about the community of busking, I'd like to see more tolerance, more collaboration, definitely. But on another level, I've just had these ideas in my head for a while of like a sort of almost like a town crier role with the busker thing, because I mean, there's, as opposed to say 200-300 years ago, there's so much more noise to cut through. We had a trick or an experiment we did maybe what 2 or 3 weeks ago where we did water. It was the first time we had done one of those experiments, and we did a song for water, and we talked about water and its value and how central it is to our lives and our bodies. And then we talked about fracking and WNC and that whole thing for a little bit. And that's an idea, because people on the street, they see so little of what this place is. Downtown is an incomplete representation of what this region is, and they get to see little slices of it. But a lot of them, they come, drink some good beer, have some good food, listen to some good music. Oh, it was a great vacation. Go on home. Maybe they drive around on the Blue Ridge Parkway, but they don't understand the cost of the whole set of interactions that brought them there in the first place. Like, what happens when a tourist town blows up, you know? How are the people who are bringing you your food living? You know, how are the people who are living in these mountains you're driving around in? You know, is their water going to be safe to drink from their well that their whole family's been drinking on for generations? Stuff like that. And so I feel like I haven't seen anyone else be able to stop strangers and tell them something or show them something and have them pay attention the way buskers can. And so I wonder if there's a role for us moving forward.
Yeah, that's real good thinking. Even now, okay, folks, we're downtown next to the public library, between the public library and the Civic Center.
The U.S. And Cellular Center. There's another one of them.
Well, right across the street from us is this big empty lot, and they're talking about putting a hotel there, and looking at that big old empty lot, knowing that there's a petition going around to turn it into a park, which is what I would love to see. with St. Lawrence Green, you can Google that if you're interested in signing this petition for this park, please.
please.
But yeah, they're talking about building several hotels, even the BB&T building that's over there near Pack Square. They're talking about having a hotel there.
Really?
Putting these things into place and thinking about all these extra hotels, extra hotels, extra hotels. Well, you know, there still has to be folks in there to be working in all these very, very large hotels, which, yes, could be major employers, but they are also major chains, which we don't really have a lot of that downtown, and we shouldn't really have. But
not if the uniqueness of this city is something that we really value.
There's like a 1% vacancy rate. Where are the folks that are working in these hotels supposed to live? I mean, I don't know, basic 1, 2, 3 says maybe we should think of us as people and as a community first before we start just dumping a bunch of stuff on it.
Yeah, sustainability is important.
Right, and you would think as buskers that we'd be all excited, more tourism, must be more money, but it's not that case for us.
Yeah, there's a certain point where, I mean, even on like July 4th, for example. Last year, July 4th, I was playing with Mark Hennessy to all my dear friends. We came out, we were at BB&T, actually, and every street corner, it was just packed with people, face painters, people with pretzels, like, constant thing. And so we figured, oh man, this is going to be a great day. we worked so hard, and in terms of our finances, it ended up being like a typical Saturday evening or something like that. But we put so much more energy into it. But there's this threshold where it's like, then there's too much energy in it, and people are too scattered. You can't stick them for very long. They'll like stop, listen for 30 seconds, then go to the next thing, and not have engaged long enough to feel that sense of, I don't know if obligation is the right word, but like tipping is something they want to do. So if you expand that thing, you know, if you keep pouring energy, there's a point where you have too much energy and not enough space to focus it.
Right. Right, and that's a little bit of what I'm talking about, is just keeping the culture that we have come to love sound. Mm-hmm. And especially, you know, especially within our little downtown bubble here, because all these little elements and factors and stuff are definitely going to put some sort of weights on the busking scene and on the music scene in general. Mm-hmm. and even as far as bar acts, like who's going to be coming into town and playing in those bars. Mm-hmm. The more commercial the restaurants get, the more commercial the music gets.
Mm-hmm. I'm curious how sustainable these kinds of towns even are in the big picture. Like I look at Austin and Seattle and Portland and you know, like I am an optimist, and I still have like 5-10 years in my mind of Asheville being viable source of income in a place that I want to be just in the 2 years alone. Now, I love beer. I adore it. And I love that we have some of the best beer in the world here. And in 2 years, I guess now it's the third year that I've seen it, I've watched the nightlife and my experience in the evening get worse and worse progressively, exponentially. The energy becomes aggressive and disrespectful and dangerous and all manner of unpleasantness, and I see that increasing. So I really like, if I can be done by like 10 o'clock sharp is good. Like I want to get a couple more bucks, but every time that I try to share the music past that, it's just incredibly unpleasant. Mm-hmm. as the sun goes down.
Well, there are certain kinds of music that are better suited for an audience that's been drinking a little bit. What we play, that the handpan and all of that, I don't think it can work, but it's not as conducive, you know.
Right. It's not exactly rip your shirt off and mm-hmm. swing it around here.
I mean, yeah, if you were playing some raunchy blues, then we may do a little better at 11 o'clock. I mean, right. Assuming we didn't get ticketed, because right. Technically noise ordinance.
I mean, it is what it is.
Yeah. I mean, it's also how we think about ourselves and how we perceive things. And going back to what you said about what we can do as buskers, and maybe it's not a overarching effect like mass advertising or something, but it's a very direct impact we have the potential to make on people because of that one-on-one interaction. And I feel like we are, as a consumer society, we consume and don't think, like you said, about the impact on the city, about what these people's lives are actually like. And for me, like all the bigger stories and all the stories aside, it's simple stuff like, hey, are you grateful to be alive? Because I am. Like, can we spend a moment being grateful together and just recognize, like, wow, we're here listening to music. We have food and water and we don't have drones in our face every day like a lot of people in the world do. And, you know, all of these challenges, and to just take some time to be really grateful for that. And I feel like that opens the door for connection, to like actually recognize, hey, where are you from? What are you doing in Asheville? And here, this is me and my family here. And like, we're actual people, not just like, I'm not your picture of what busking is, or I'm a person and you're a person.
Exactly. And that's kind of the point of this whole broadcast, is to put a voice and a name to it. So it's not just buskers. You know, and especially when it comes to a traveling community, because there's so much misunderstanding fogging that whole issue. But so that, you know, folks understand that everybody has a very unique story. Not all of us are none of us are anywhere near the same. And we're all very, very unique people that deserve some respect because we've been through some of the similar stuff that you do, and you also deserve respect.
Mm. That's it right there. That two-way street of understanding. Right. That's what, because, you know, I've noticed a lot that we want people to understand us, and yet we can get very up in arms when it goes the other way of like, hey, this business owner has, you know, huge expenses and they've got families too. And, you know, I recognize that, you know, in trying, I try to see things from their perspectives, even if I don't always agree, but understanding these are people too. And the city as a whole, like, we may completely disagree, but I understand that they're trying to do something in some way or form that they think is best for everybody and themselves. And that's what we're all trying to do. And so, like I said, nothing is black or white in this world. And it's good for that understanding to go both ways. I'd like to see it in myself and coworkers more to strive to understand everything and not be so quick to demonize something. Because it's really easy to point the finger, but to come up with sustainable, better solutions that enrich our environment, that's where, you know, it's really at, and that's challenging.
Well, to do that, it requires a broader understanding than we typically allow ourselves to have about, like, you know, looking at, let's say we're talking about gentrification in Asheville, and I hear a lot of talk about it. It's a very hot topic lately because a lot of people in my community are having trouble affording where to live or having places to live or basic living expenses, etc. One thing I don't hear us talking about is the people that were dispossessed so that we could come in. And, like, to understand how long this process has been going on, that as much as we may talk against it and try to find solutions to it, our presence here is part of that. You know, like, all the black people who are now mostly in project housing and 5 project housing spots, or a couple neighborhoods that are, the houses are getting bought up, developers are coming in. Like, it's a long process, and, like, acknowledging our own part in that. And as buskers especially, like, we tend to travel around from, there's these cultural hotspots that pop up. For whatever reason, you have a Haight-Ashbury or an Asheville or a Portland and some combination of something going on there and the economy there. It makes it a good place for artists to show up and do their thing. Then it becomes cool, people start moving there, funky stores start popping up, then developers come in, and it happens over and over again. This is a major, major issue in our country, and this is the circuit we kind of run as buskers. So we have a special insight into that because we go back and forth from places where it keeps happening, because that's where we can make a living, you know? And it's such a small handful of places, and they all kind of fit into that same category. It's a fascinating phenomenon.
So have you all busked in New Orleans?
Yeah. Yes. Yes, we have. Not together, but we spent some time on Royal Street.
Now, in comparison, the cultures.
Well, it's way more competitive. Okay, so here's an interesting thing. So I'm from Atlanta, which is a big city. I don't miss Atlanta very much, but there's certain weird things I miss about it that I like about New Orleans. I don't particularly miss crime, but there's something about living in a place where there's crime that keeps people on their grind, keeps people aware of their environment, focused, like, moving in some fashion, whether they're moving back and forth or moving up or down or forward. There's a certain catalyst towards motion, and so that makes people hustle. I think that's good because we're very
stagnant.
Yeah. Yeah, it's easy in our comfortable little mountain town with our good beer and our great food and awesome weather to get kind of lazy. It's super easy. And so I really enjoy that New Orleans is hopping. Now, that said, it's really rough to get a spot on Royal Street.
Oh,
it's
my goodness.
Really rough.
Yeah, when I went down with Mark, who Josh has also played with, to all my dear friends, and we did a couple weeks together, and we were planning on doing a month together. We're like, okay, we were excited about the notion that you can hold a spot all day once you get it, and that seemed appealing. But, you know, the reality of being on a spot around midnight or 1 a.m. or 2 a.m. And being there all night sunk in really, really soon, especially with my wife who's pregnant at the time. She wanted to be a part of it all. we couldn't swing that. But yeah, sleeping in the car, taking shifts, and the first 3 days we were there, we got pushed off our spots 3 days in a row. And
who pushed you off?
Well,
we're calling you.
There's
out, I guess.
There's bigger context than I want to get into around that.
Okay, all right.
We'll let them slide.
I've been invaded.
Yeah.
In New Orleans before. You are not alone.
Yeah. It's funny, you know, there's the style of like, I'm just going to say a bunch of stuff and not actually do anything and just cast a big mist over everything. Then there's the hyper-aggressive style where, no, you get out of here now. And then there's the subtle thing where, like, I'm going to get you thrown in jail or beaten up if you keep taking my spot. And all these really intense things we do not have to deal with here.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Which is neat. And that polarity of like, I love New Orleans, I hate New Orleans equally. And it's really, that is like super hyperbolic in that way. Like, highs are so beautiful. Like, we went and one of the people that we had a big argument with, Doris and Tanya, ended up being one of our closest friends down there and a huge inspiration to both of us. And out of all of this conflict, one night we decided to play, and about six of us all got together and played all together. And there were all these rumors going around like, hey, this person took your spot and this is happening. And all this tension was building. Then all of a sudden, all of us playing together created this huge healing. And there were maybe 50 to 100 people there all night for 5-6 hours. And that was magnificent, you know? And whew, you know, included in that bunch was a man in his late 80s or early 90s playing guitar, been doing it his whole life, world-class musician, and astounding to be around that kind of energy. And
you, Gramps?
Yes.
Cool. Yeah, so. Awesome.
I had a similar one of those while I was down there. It started out like yours with a conflict over a spot with some buskers, and they had it by rights. I'm not going to go into too much detail, but there was a conflict, then it was resolved, and the next day we worked together to hold a spot instead of like trying to snag it and hold it all day. Mark and I, and then one of the people who we had a conflict with the previous day, shared the spot the next day, and it was awesome. And so I jammed with, this is Nathan Riviera, he was just in town. Really cool dude.
Yeah.
And so he and I jammed, and then this woman who plays violin, whose name, there were so many of them, I've forgotten most of the names, but she was awesome. I hope I remember your name or see you again one day, whoever you are. So we jammed, and then a guitar player and a banjo player showed up, and then an upright bassist and a washboard player showed up. By the end of it, there were like 9 of us playing together, and it was amazing. And that's something that I don't see happen here that I do see in New Orleans, that I guess maybe because of jazz.
Super bands?
Yeah.
Yeah, super bands, and super bands don't happen too often here, and I think maybe... Well, I guess they used to. A couple years back, it was a popular thing for a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
But recently, no.
I mean, it's so interesting, the life of a city. And really, it can take a lifetime understanding the full context. Like, New Orleans has got so much history and so much going on between the culture and the different people have come through, and race and economy and all of this stuff that, you know, I feel like I understand maybe a fraction of it, and because I was ignorant and acting a fool and had people educate me. And even so, still, like, I don't have those life experiences even close. You know, I live a very, you know, overall relaxed life here in Asheville. And so it's interesting how different every city's character is. And I think, you know, there are pros and cons to everywhere. And I think we got it pretty good here.
Yeah, we have it really good here. It's easy to forget sometimes.
I mean, the fact that there's an unspoken etiquette is...
It's extremely rare.
Very rare. I've never seen that anywhere.
Now I got to say something to our audience real quick.
You're listening to WPVM 103.7 FM in Asheville. You can listen to us online at WPVMFM.org. I say that every hour.
Awesome.
I want to play y'all something pretty while we're at it.
Yeah, that sounds like an awesome idea.
I'm gonna play, kind of give you an idea of how different these instruments can be.
Please do.
You want happy or dark? What should we do?
Ooh. How about you do dark and then happy to cheers back up?
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Okay.
So you leave on a high note.
All right, so we'll start with this. This is one of my favorite instruments on the planet. This is a halo made by Pantheon Steel out of Missouri.
Do you have a name for that little tune?
The instrument scale is called Ursa Minor.
Ursa Minor.
Yeah.
That's kind of cool.
Yeah. It's real purdy like. It's a B minor. All right, so I'd like to play this one for you on the happy end. This is like sugar sweet happy. This scale is actually named after our daughter, Isha Savita, and it was built by our friend Isan in Switzerland. Echo sound sculpture.
Is that paint on top?
Yeah, this is his logo. The two yellow bands.
Yeah, two gold rings on the top of the dome.
Yeah, he was a visual artist prior to doing hand pans and does really beautiful stuff. And now it's starting to shift with some other aesthetic choices, like brassing inside these little dimples. But aesthetics are very important to him sonically and visually. So.
Thank you.
Yeah, we were trying to decide what scale to get from him and. Heard this beautiful scale at Pantheon Steel and brought it up a whole step and really love it here. So it was a new thing for him to try, and we're grateful that he tried it for us, and I think it came out as a real lovely, lovely scale. And so for us, it's really about the celebration of the birth of our child and new chapter in our life and the playfulness of all that goodness. We're gonna play this, Josh and I, together. He hasn't played the scale much, so this should be a fun surprise. Yeah, they're kind of like spherical spaceship looking things, so one of the real great joys is playing four hands, setting it and facing one another and playing together.
Yeah.
All right. Something like that.
I think the very first day we played, at some point before I, you set up first, and then I came up, and I think we did a four-hand jam before we played together.
It's kind of awkward with the setup.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, it was pretty awkward.
We have so much
right.
gear. I have two didgeridoos in front of me when I play on big heavy metal racks, and they've got to be big heavy metal stands because...
Because they're so heavy to begin with, and the wind.
Yeah, and if they fall on an instrument, like the one I play, I have to send to Russia or to California to get tuned, and it's, yeah, no bueno.
No bueno. And so I, on the street, I have a hybrid kit, basically. I started out concert band, but also drum kit, and I've played drum kit for a long time, and so I'm accustomed to using my feet as well as my hands. And so I have the hand pan on a snare drum stand, and then I have a mini kick drum. It's actually a modified floor tom. And I have a hi-hat that I used mainly for timekeeping. I have a clave foot pedal. Clave is a, it's like the... It's a click sound that I can play with my left heel, and I have a cymbal. And using that, I create these polyrhythms, and then we interact melodically and percussively as well.
Now, didgeridoos. You want to give us a little history on
that? Yeah, yeah. So I have two here, and I'll play them kind of side by side a little bit so you can get a feel for how some of the different ones work. So you want to grab that just so I don't knock your pan around.
We have the entire floor of the side of the room covered with instruments.
Yeah, there's not much room in this tiny little studio, folks. But we're squeezing in here just for you.
That's right.
So, like I said, the hand pan was invented in 2000. It's the first acoustic instrument that's really in the 21st century, as far as I know. And a real distinct instrument at that, and only possible in the 21st century because of the way we work with steel, and there's some power tools and nitriding that needs to happen. So it's really interesting that all this industrialization gave birth to such an acoustic, ancient sounding instrument.
Yeah.
The didgeridoo, on the other hand, is played cross-culturally all around the planet throughout history, but mostly known to the world and most consistently played by the indigenous people of the Northern Territories of Australia, the Aboriginal folks up there. So we play, the newest and the oldest instruments, just about. Well, the drum's pretty old, too. Drum and voice, and then didgeridoo, I'd say. So, anyhow, I wasn't there. I don't really know. So, to be clear, I'm not playing any indigenous songs or indigenous styles. The only thing that is similar is that they're both big hollow logs. I adore that culture, but that's not what I'm doing. I'm just playing the things that bring me joy. All right, let's see. So this first one is a D. I'm playing. It's
so they're all tuned to different keys, and
sometimes they're really random, just somewhere in between in the microtonal jungle. The ones that I play for the street are tuned because I like that to be in tune with my instrument. Just creates a strong effect.
Yeah.
Anyways, this one I built in particular to work with my instrument and some of the other instruments I have, this D. Anyways, without further ado.
Thank you. How often have you played the didgeridoo along with other styles of music or different than what you're normally?
As often as I can.
Have you ever played it to jazz or something?
Yeah, yeah. I was really, that time I was talking about in New Orleans when we were all playing together, it was a great example of a bunch of people, and I was real excited about the handpan. Doris kept looking at me like, didgeridoo, grab the didgeridoo, and it was great to be encouraged to play it because I've, for whatever reason, it kind of feels like a novel secondary instrument where it's kind of neat sort of thing.
That people talk about the spoons that way.
Yeah.
You're in good company.
Yeah. Interesting stuff. Like, and you're same thing with spoons. You don't have a lot of community to talk right. to about what you do. And but this year, really, a lot of it had to do this winter. I need to take a break from the street and reanalyze. And it's easy to lose passion for an instrument. I lost passion for didge. It became all mental. How can I play it more technically, this and that? And I started because I love the way it makes me feel. I love the way it sounds. And so I lost touch with that. And really playing with Josh has been a great, great reawakening because he's got the rhythm. He's got the handpan going. I can really focus on the didgeridoo. We brought out two for the first time this weekend, which was a blast. And really get to focus on how much I love this instrument, how powerful and impactful it is. For me, the breath, the instruments of breath, like the voice, and they're so powerful because in this infinite strange world, it's the merging of all things. This breath that connects us to the same breath that our ancestors breathed, the same breath. Actually, scientifically, there are particles of almost every living human being in the breaths that we take. And quite astounding. And so that comes in and merges with the consciousness of a living human being. And so for me, it's really the connection with the finite and the infinite. It's the mixture of this bodily world with the unseen. And yeah, powerful way to carry that, whether it's conscious or unconscious, just carry that subtlety out there.
Well, that being said, it seemed like a lot of your breath was coming straight from your gut. Which is, we talk about chakras and stuff. Mm. We're talking about that's the centermost part of you. And so
that's been one of the fascinating things about playing this instrument. It's completely like there's everything else we do in our life, we have a fair idea like how the hands work. Like I've used my hands a lot growing up, but then like I teach the dige. It's one of the most fascinating things to teach because we're using muscles like the soft palate and your throat and the inside of your abdomen and diaphragm and all these things in ways that we don't really focus on. So it really brings the intention internally. And I didn't notice until I forgot my dige a couple weeks ago. And I played and I wasn't really enjoying myself very much at all. And I realized, wow, and I felt really heavy. And I realized then how much energy I get from playing it, as much energy as it requires. And I get a tremendous amount of energy from, you get really, it's the cheapest way to get high. Taking in so much breath. And yeah, it's just, It's a deeply embodying, fun instrument.
Well, Josh, you're playing coming up. Are you playing with him for PAX Square?
The June 28th, the Pritchard Park thing. I think we're doing that together.
Right. So you got Pritchard Park on the 28th. That's that Sunday.
It's PAX Square. Yeah, you're right.
It's PAX Square for the 28th, and that's the Sunday concert series put on by the Downtown Association. And then you're also doing some handpan events. Is that correct?
Well, my friends and I co-produced the, as far as I know, the largest handpan gathering in the world.
And it's. Where and when?
Yeah, let me tell you all about it. It's a 4-day weekend. It's in Camp Hope in Canton, North Carolina. The website is hangout-usa.com. And I think we've got a handful of tickets left. If you want to go, I would get online quick because they're going to go. And we have camping and tents, and we fly in some of the best players from around the world, and we do workshops all weekend, concerts every night, food included, And it's just a really sweet, sweet time. Incredible people coming in from all around the world. And,
awesome.
Yeah. And that's July.
I'll post some links. July what?
July 16th through the 20th.
Okay, July 16th through the 20th. You got to get your hand pan on. I will be posting the links on our pages. So if you're wanting to go and figure out how to get there, then you can go and look there.
That's right.
If you're interested. what's the site again?
Hangout-USA.com.
Hangout-USA.com. Awesome. Now, where do we find y'all's music online? And or how do we find you on the interweb? If I wanted to book you,
that's
where do
right.
I go?
Well, I have a lot of stuff online. Everything is connected through my name, Peter Levitov, L-E-V-I-T-O-V. And that's my Facebook, Bandcamp, YouTube, all of that. Peter Levitov, Peter Levitov Music, and my email as well, at Gmail. And as far as us together go, we're in our first month of doing it. So
yeah, we're still, we don't even know what to call ourselves.
well, when you figure that out, we'll have you back in, and we'll do this again. You can maybe tell us how your summer went or however.
Yeah.
You know, I'd like to do recaps with some folks coming up at the end of the season.
Yeah, recaps would be nice.
You don't want to play anymore?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Let's play some
more.
You're
going to have to beat us out of here with sticks. We'll play all day.
I can check to see if there's a show at 6.
Well, I've got these other instruments called tabla that I brought.
Yeah.
And so I could
and where do those where do those instruments come from?
They are from India. The tabla themselves have been around for roughly 500 years. There's some scholarly debate over who was the original inventor of it or when it came about. But Indian classical is one of the oldest musical systems in the world. It goes back to the Vedas, which are some of the oldest religious texts in the world, 3,000 some odd years. And the system of Indian classical, it's gone through several evolutions, but its origin is in the Vedas and has been practiced since then. But there's another instrument called the mridangam or the khol, which is basically, if you took tabla, which are two drums, a high and a low drum, and you put the bottom ends together, so, and hung it around your neck or sat it in your lap, that's the instrument. And at some point, someone had the bright idea of turning it into two drums. One very interesting thing about this instrument, it's one of the only percussion instruments that I know of that major drum companies have been unable to reproduce. So there's the high drum, the tabla, is made of wood, and then it has three layers of goat skin and a black dot.
And what is the black dot?
The black dot is called the siyahi, and the thing about it is no one knows, except for Indian drum makers, no one knows how to produce it. It's a paste that we know there's wheat flour, iron filings, and a whole bunch of other stuff, but they've kept the method of creating it and applying it pretty secret. And so they apply it in a paste, and then as it dries, it cracks. If you look closely at the head, you'll see it's not a continuous dot, but it's actually numerous pieces, and that's what gives them their sort of bell-like tone when you strike them. But no one else has figured out how to do it. A couple companies have tried and failed miserably.
Kind of like a Coca-Cola recipe?
Yeah, exactly. It's quite the metaphor. But yeah, so I'm going to play these a little bit.
You want some jazz QR?
Yeah, if you don't mind for me to do a little bit solo. And then,
yes, please.
And then I'll give you a look.
Give me the look. That tasty look.
Looking at you, buddy.
Things are getting hot and heavy here. That's right. At WPVM, folks.
Temperature gets this high, you never know what'll happen.
You can come look in the window now if you want, but I might be shutting the curtain soon.
You don't have to. The steam's going to do that for us.
There you go. Can you tell me if you can hear these all right? around and talk some more. Another interesting thing about these instruments, they do not respond well to humidity. They go out of tune very quickly. And I actually tune them by taking this hammer and hitting along the side of the rim. So this part is sharp, so I'm gonna go like this. And now it's a little closer.
He just tapped it once with a little metal hammer the side of his drum. There. It's kind of neat, you know?
Yeah, it's definitely a pain sometimes when... Another thing that will happen is as your hands are on it, when you first start playing, over the course of, say, the first 5 minutes of playing, the drums will respond to your body heat and drop sometimes as much as half a step. If you're playing in a big crowded room and people are excited and dancing, they'll drop just because people are sweating and the room is getting hot. So it's a very delicate kind of upkeep. Close enough. I can work with that. Peter, you want to join in here?
Yeah. I'm playing a scale called Hejazkar. It's inspired from a Turkish makam. Makam is like similar to Indian music with the raga. It's not necessarily a scale, but a certain notes and relationships based off of the context of the piece, whether you're ascending or descending. So I won't be playing it in the traditional makam, but that's what it's inspired by. It's a SPB by Victor Levinson, SPB Pantom. He's south of St. Petersburg.
Let's start it off.
Oh my goodness gracious.
Goodness gracious.
Thank you.
Wee.
That's great. I love rhythm.
It's a lot of fun.
Well, it's so universal. You know, it doesn't matter what language you speak, you understand what's going on. You know? It's awesome.
It draws you into it.
Yeah. That's
right. So there's an interesting thing. You mentioned right before you started playing Didgeridoo, Peter, that you weren't playing any indigenous songs or anything like that. So it's an interesting thing. You hear the term cultural appropriation being thrown around a lot, which is definitely a delicate thing. For playing tabla, for instance, it's in India. If you're an Indian classical musician, that is what you do. You don't play other instruments. You don't have another job. I mean, as like professional tabla players, at some point you go on at least one tabla retreat, and basically a cabin in the wilderness is prepared for you, enough food and supplies to get you through, and you go by yourself for 40 days, and you don't do anything but play tabla for 40 days by yourself in the wilderness. And most people, like, you know, by day five or day six, they're starting to see their ancestors, or the head of the tabla grows a mouth and starts talking to them and teaching them things, or crazy mystical experiences happen. And so for me, I mainly learned from YouTube. So I'm
keeping it real.
Right. I don't really, you know, it's not available to me in the same way, right, to be a part of that tradition. If it were, I'm not entirely sure that I would, because I like playing other instruments as well. But it's really interesting to, like, when there's a tradition that you're drawing off of, like, what are the boundaries for honoring that tradition, and but then also having your own creativity or taking it out of context and placing it somewhere else. And so, Abby, you've been keeping the spoons thing alive, and that's a very old tradition. What's your perspective on
that? Well, it is and isn't. It's kind of the same thing that where you're sitting too, mm-hmm. where you know, traditional spoon playing is generalistically speaking for America's wooden spoons, and you're hitting them on and off your knee. Mm-hmm. And all the fancy stuff I do in the air, all those kinds of things, it's actually very rare that you ever find anybody that does any of that. Mm. And there's only one other person in the country that's ever taken it to that level professionally.
Right.
And so, I mean, that specific style, mm-hmm. you know, which would be Artist the Spoon Man. And he's much better at it than I am. for the record, folks, he deserves much respect. You know, so I don't know. It's kind of a tricky subject when you go talking about that. You know, because I feel like maybe I'm pulling off of that tradition. Yes and no. Mm-hmm. Kind of. I guess maybe the same way you kind of feel.
Yeah,
I think it's really fascinating. Didgeridoo is the same thing. I mean, it's been used as having a very central role in ceremony for the people who love it, you know, and a lot of the instruments I like to play have this connection. American Indian style flute or birimbau and kanjira, these old instruments that have these deep spiritual implications. And there's this American thing where it's like, we have this consumer entitlement mentality. We take what we want and don't think about it too much, put it all in a big pot and spit it out. And I think that, you know, on one hand, that can be very destructive to, as we see indigenous lands being destroyed and indigenous cultures being uprooted from the bottom up. It also creates something really unique in that washing of the slate, the wiping of the slate clean. Like, I've seen a lot of traditions that in one way or another dry up or can lose connection to the sincerity and the freshness of coming to it new with no cultural
context.
Exactly, no cultural context, just a fascination with the sound. And that's the challenge that I know both of us face on the street of, like, how do I come out here to make money and also be in integrity with myself in terms of offering my sincere practice, my sincerity in terms of love and devotion to the sound, the deepest parts of myself that I feel. How do I bring that out here and in a way that I feel good about what I'm sharing, without also putting, like, my most tender part out and feeling like smudge. Mm. And it's a fine line to walk. Because sometimes I'm out all day and I'm just thinking about money and how am I going to support my family and this bill and that bill. And I look up and I realize I've been under a tree all day and I haven't looked once at how beautiful this tree is or the sky is or the people or my friends next to me or paid attention to what the air feels like in my lungs. And when that happens, it can be a very heavy feeling for me. I'm like, what am I doing any of this for? And then there's times where it's like, I'm aware that I want to bring the sincerity, but I can't access it. And so I'm just sitting there watching myself do the same slop that I do because I know people like it because it's fast and fancy, but there's no heart. And I'm just waiting patiently, hoping and praying that, my goodness, I can bring something that's real and has substance.
Yeah.
I've learned part of my process of growth as a musician is it's more like psychological judo, sort of, or aikido. I have to misdirect the machinations of my own brain to like get out of the way so I can speak with sincerity. And it's, I feel like in when I watch musicians who I consider peers, when I watch musicians who are what I would consider masters, and when I watch new musicians, I can see this progression of, you know, with some musicians first starting out, they're still getting used to the techniques, or they're really focused on how to play the instrument, how to play the right notes. Even the notion that there are is such a thing as a right note. Well, there's a whole bunch of stuff tied up into that. But then when I watch the masters, the people who are just really talented at expressing, and I'm not concerned with what note or what scale or what time signature they're in, because they're putting so much of themselves into every single note. And it seems like I'm sure they have days just like me, but it seems that there aren't barriers to their sincerity. They've learned how to vault over those barriers or knock them down or go around them in a way that keeps some truth to their expressions and a genuine quality that is easily lost, especially when it becomes your career and you have money tied up into it. And, you know, there's also, this is something that's relatively new in the scheme of history, this idea of being a performer and being this image that people are purchasing and that sort of commodification. It makes it tricky to hold on to the heart of things sometimes. And so that's part of my process of growth.
Yeah, see, they're giggling because they already know. I have definitely branded myself. You know, like, yeah, I definitely have. And so a lot of what you're talking about I can definitely relate to. As far as, you know, some days I feel like a breathing tourist attraction. You know?
Yeah, spectacle.
I mean, for me, right. I don't know about you, but when I go to that place, I feel like I'm selling the most sacred part of myself. And that feels terrible sometimes, where it's like, and it's about the sale of that instead of the offering. Because when I'm in a good place, it's like, I'm just grateful to be alive. Here you are, Spirit. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to be here. And let me share that, and hopefully makes a person or two smile and enjoy themselves too.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but truth is truth. And when you're doing it for a living and it is the way that you pay bills and you have a family, like Peter just recently had a baby, then it can be stressful and it can get competitive and it can also get frustrating and not feel like the thing that you love anymore. And so making drawing those clear boundaries for yourself so that you can continue to come out and feel like a whole person while you're coming out is really, really important. If you're going to be doing this whole time. It's extremely hard work, and besides sitting there and playing and that whole part of it, just the complete performance and talking with folks and being there all day and being in the heat and waiting for spots and and the competition, quote unquote, that's kind of subtly there between all the performers, can weigh on you after a while.
So much energy out there.
Right. And so it's important to set that boundary for yourself.
Yeah.
I mean, there's unseen costs to everything, and I, I mean, if I had a magic wand and I could have people understand a couple things, this is the sort of thing I'd like them to understand. I don't expect them to, because they're not doing it full time. But as an artist, especially on the street, we are sharing the deepest parts of ourselves and asking so much. I mean, like you said, aside from the fact that, like, I go home exhausted, my shoulder, my neck hurts, my back hurts, my abdomen hurts, and, like, I need 3 full days just to feel ready to go do it again, and then, hey, it's time to do it again. Besides all of that, besides, like, speaking to all the people on the street, some really beautiful, some really challenging, some in a good place, some in a really challenging place, and you're out there, so you're holding space and talking to these people, and, like, all the energy that that requires, coming home, feeling scatterbrained. Like, I spend all of Monday walking around, staring at the wall, kind of, like, in the feeling in the middle of of life, just like, what happened? So there's all that physical, mental stuff. And then we're out there trying to really bring something beautiful and honest and sincere. And like Dade Murphy, the windblown man, is a great example. I love him dearly, and I've seen people give him so much trouble about how he does this and how he does that. And
it's magic, folks. If you're wondering how he does
that's
it,
right.
It is magic.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right. I mean, and it's not totally fair. He hires some elves to help him out, but...
Yeah, yeah.
You know, but whatever. We got to work with what we got. And
heard they're going to unionize soon. We got to... We'll see what goes on when the elves unionize.
But the point I've seen with him, what I really love about what he brings to his work is, like, hey, I'm not a puzzle to be figured out. Like, and people don't recognize, like, what we're doing to put ourselves out there, how much we're putting on the line every time we're out there. And like I said, there are days consistently where I'm like, okay, I never want to do this again. I'm like playing in the woods alone. I'm never sharing this for another person, because you're just out there so vulnerable and so tender. And people don't necessarily see that, because for whatever reason, lots of other jobs don't demand that of you. But here, for us to feel good about what we offer very often, you have to just constantly be questioning yourself about the value of what you're bringing. And
well, yeah, well, you're offering up a piece of yourself, saying take it or leave it. Yeah. And the feeling of rejection can be there very consistently on some of those days. And it's just going to happen, because we're all human and everybody else around here is human. And, you know, and another thing is it kind of seems like, you know, when one performer seems to be having a slow, quote-unquote, day, the rest of us do, too. Mm-hmm. You know, the city kind of lives and breathes organically just with us, you know, right with us. Mm-hmm. And we all kind of share in those emotions.
Mm.
Pretty much.
Yeah, that's been the beautiful thing about doing this consistently enough to relate with the people I'm doing this work with, taking time to say, like, hey, how are you? Mm-hmm. Like, not just I listen to your music here or there and, like, when are you done? I want your spot. But how's your life? Where are you living? What are you doing? And
there's so much more communication here.
It's definitely important. It is interesting to, like, I guess my term for it is city augury. Like, it's the same kind of concept of, like, the old timers out in the country can look at the clouds and be like, you know, it's going to rain in about 3.5 hours. And I can look at what the bears are doing and tell you something about the winter. Like, there's these little telltale signs in nature that let you know what's going on. And the city has those, too.
Oh,
I mean, like, one of my primary ones is I'm coming from West Asheville. So I get on 240 East, and you come around that bend right before Patton Avenue where it merges with the other two, and everyone's trying to get over to the left, or no one knows what they're doing. And the stupider it is on the highway at that point tells me how many people are in town. Like, if it's just if it's going 15 miles an hour around that curve, it's gonna be a good day. Usually
there's subtle magic there too. Like, it's interesting when you feel, you can start to feel how the city's breathing, the pace of the breath, and, like, when it's sick, and little things you can do to kind of help. And, like, I've noticed there's really interesting like compositional melodic overtures at the whole city. Like, I'll notice there are moments the wind picks up, starts mm-hmm. blowing strongly. At the exact same moment, a fire truck starts going. At the exact same moment, a drunk goes off in the corner. And at the exact same moment, something important of mine falls over. Mm-hmm. And it's like, wow.
There's like a whip crack through.
Yeah, completely amazing to see how interconnected things can be. And like, yeah, oftentimes a bunch of us getting sick or a bunch of us down. And like, okay, it's time, like, I know I came out here to work, but today I'm just spending all day talking to these people, just connecting, making connections. I don't care about the money. Like, it's important. And that kind of subtlety is sweet to see develop and help us all connect and stay connected and real. You say, keep that jank real.
It's cool. I didn't realize until I got out on the street how much, street psychologist or sometimes mediator or, you know, things like that. Like, there's the service of offering up the music, but the street asks a lot more of you than that. You know, it's cool, too, because home bums, talking to local homeless people and the relationship with that is, like, a really interesting side of the city that not many other people really get to dive into, I think, the way buskers do, because we occupy the same corners and you get to know people, you know? Like, oftentimes you and other buskers are the only live music they get to hear anymore because they're not welcome in bars or what have you. Sometimes, like, street people, whether it's buskers or vendors, are the only people who treat them like human beings, who will look them in the eye, who know their name. And
Little Tennessee.
Yeah.
Or Cherokee.
Yeah.
There's some really awesome people out there.
Yeah.
Cherokee loves to dance.
He does love to dance.
You know, and then the folks from, like, right here, folks, we're in the first floor of the Vanderbilt building, and upstairs we have the, you know, it's kind of a retirement home upstairs. And a lot of those ladies from the retirement home just love to run around and listen to the street performers and hang out. Like, Sharon Woody is one of my favorite people.
She's awesome. She's totally so awesome. Yeah.
Okay, so real quick.
Yes.
About indicators in a city about how things are going to go. Cherokee is one of my indicators because they know, like, a lot of buskers, like, if you're not feeling it, you notice other buskers are like, I'm not feeling it today, you know, kind of down. Cherokee is my indicator because I'm not feeling it. I'm trying to play. He'll come, he'll start dancing a little bit, and he'll just walk off. I'm like, oh, it's real, you know.
Cherokee's not feeling it.
Yeah. Shoot. He is kind of a bellwether in that way.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
What a funny job.
Oh, it's a completely funny job. I giggle at myself, thinking to myself, I play silverware for a living.
Uh-huh.
This is not what I expected in my life.
At least you don't blow into a log.
That's an awfully strange looking trumpet.
I'll
you
tell
got
you
there.
What.
Well, I play a wok, apparently.
Yeah,
so,
right.
Or a Weber trap. Grill.
Yeah.
Well, you know, them wok players by the iron.
I saw a guy that thought you were playing a piece of paraphernalia.
Oh, yeah.
He's like, you make music with those? It's like, all right, yeah. Sure.
What's interesting about, like, you're saying with the folks who seem really hard up and who normally I would avoid just instinctually and culturally programmed, like, this is more trouble than I have time for today. You're out there every day, so after a year of seeing the same person, eventually, you know, hopefully it doesn't take me that long, but eventually I'm like, okay, there's the human being I see every day. Let me connect with them. And, like, you know, the street gives you that opportunity to learn the other 999 ways other people suffer besides myself. And, like, giving me perspective, real perspective. And also, like, I adore the insane, the sick, and the crazy folks out in the town, because for me, they're no different than all of us. The only difference is that thing that tells them not to do it in public got lifted. And, like, that's going on in all of our minds, in the back, these conversations, talking to ourselves, all, and they allow us a mirror to see it, like, really up in my face, like, wow. And the more I speak to them, I realize, like, I'm not that much different from you, and only a couple, the wind just needs to blow a little different, and I could be in your same situation, to really ground into gratitude, into connection. And,
you know, the thing you're talking about, trying to find that place where you could, like, express yourself through music, it's a matter of being that guy where that thing is lifted, but having a musical outlet instead.
Right.
Then you're a genius.
Yeah. Well, have you guys ever had with let's say someone seemingly schizophrenic or something like that, where they come interact with you and you're like, what is this person talking about? Then they say something that's just like a knife to your heart, or like they'll just like somehow pick out the most tender point of what's been going on in your internal world and say it to you.
I recently had somebody point out something about me, about my physical appearance, that I can't help, and it really hurts. It really does hurt when people do that. And sometimes it just, like, bursts your bubble, and you'd be having, like, you'd be out there ready to play, like, about to set up, and then somebody says something to you, and it's just like, I don't even want to do this anymore. Why am I even downtown? Why do I even bother gifting this to folks, you know? And then, and, you know, it's like all the folks that genuinely appreciate it somehow fade out of your brain, and you forget. Mm. You know, you have to be... Somebody has to come back and show you again.
Yeah.
I don't know if I'm explaining that
correctly. No, completely. I had the same thing happen to me this weekend. A friend that I really trust told me something that I believed for years, and I realized it was just like a complete lie. And like, I had a moment where I thought I was going to be one of those crazy people. I was just like, I don't know what's real anymore. I don't want to do this. I just, what's truth? I don't know. And it's an endurance game out there. And like, and we get the high highs, so magical and powerful. And you know, with any, you got to pay for everything. There's no free lunch. And
yes, if, up and down.
That's right. If I can remember that, like when it gets bad, and remember it's an endurance game, mm-hmm. that then it's, it can make those moments a little bit easier. And also a reminder that like everyone's free to do what they want. And the only thing I can do is know what's true for me to offer the best. You know, to say thank you the best that I can every day, you know, and not count those bills too closely and mm-hmm. this and that, and recognize there's so much more in the giving and taking than just that. And then I can go a little less crazy, a little bit.
I got very early in my actual, like when I was seriously busking, I got checked on that. I was involved in another project, and there's always that balance, like you said, the give and take. You know, this is my offering, this is my living, you know, and I have to consider both of those, and it's a very delicate balance. And we were out of balance, and this schizophrenic homeless woman who I've seen before, who's normally like very troublesome, and I kind of, that's one of the few people I'll try not to interact with because it rarely is productive in any way. Or even seemingly helpful, but she was mumbling something, then she practically shouted at me, "You're just a taker." And I went, whoa. And there was all this...
Oh, that's deep. Yeah, that's deep.
Yeah.
That's deep.
Like, am I really? Mm-hmm. And, you know, I didn't feel like it was as clean as that, but that's, you know, the world holds up a mirror for you.
It
does. And then I had to really look at myself. I'm like, am I offering up? I don't know.
All right, folks, we only have a couple of minutes left, so I want to ask you guys this question before we get off the air.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Are there things that you, or one or two things that you wish that other performers would follow and or bring with them downtown, attitudes, anything like that?
There's a couple. I mean, we talked about general tolerance before, and I think even in the time I've been playing, it seems to be... People seem to be, I see less arguments and more people hanging out. That's nice. But I'd like to see collaboration, and I'd like to see more community building. You know, like us like taking time to like be grateful for the blessing we have in this town, and like how easily we can do this compared to other places, and take time to give back as a group to other parts of our town that need help is something I'd like to see.
There you go.
Yeah. There's a couple for me. The main one is, you know, there's this term triangulation when we talk to somebody else about somebody else. And I'd love to just see that triangle turn into a straight line more and more regularly of just like, and it, you know, like I invite all those folks out there. If you're upset with me, like bring your anger and your rage to me. I want to hear it. I want to connect with you emotionally and understand if I've done anything, like even if I disagree with you, I still want to know and have a dialogue and be able to create something smoother.
So you can fix it.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, folks. talk to each other. Communication. You are listening to Busker Broadcast. We've got Peter and Josh and Billy Scribbles and the Spoon Lady. We've got Kevin over here with the camera, and he's been here this whole time. He's Kevin Russ. Look him up. Google it. All right. So, folks, if you're interested in being part of this broadcast, find Busker Broadcast on Facebook. If you're interested in learning about street performing here, want to know about some rules, have some questions, concerns, AshevilleBuskersCollective@gmail.com, or find us on Facebook, or SpoonLadyMusic.com. If you're interested in getting hold of me, and your stuff is...
My stuff, Peter Levitov, LEVITOV.com.
All right.
I'm just all over the place.
just come and find them next weekend and prepare to have a good time. And
that's right.
In the meantime, have an awesome week.
Thank you.
So,
hey, if y'all want to learn how to play logs or spaceships, I teach and I love it.
All right. So thanks for coming on the air.
Thank you so
much. Awesome.
Thank you.
All right. Good evening, folks, and have a great dinner.